What do I mean by this? Let's take the problem of choice. Of course, as all those guys, Ulrich Beck, Anthony Giddens taught us, we live in a society of choice, blah, blah. Okay, the standard Marxist criticism would have been, and there is an element of truth in it, that all these choices are superficial, fake choices, which mask the absence of a true choice. And it's true. Recently I was in Chicago in one of the highly developed hotels, and it was a nightmare just to check in. You know, you have to go to some 20-30, you know. Do you want back window, front window? Do you want soft pillow, hard pillow? Do you want, like, all this excessive freedom which masks the fact that, you know, it's like my best metaphor for me of our freedom today is like, this, there are these stupid choices, like, you know, oh, big freedom, Coca-Cola, Pepsi-Cola, you know, and so on, right? Two of the same. But the problem is not just this, where is the real choice. The problem, I think, is that we are often in a much more tragic situation. We are, how should I put it, forced to make choices without really having even the coordinates of what the choices are about. For example, let's take ecology. I'm totally pro-ecologist. But I think that the intelligent, honest, green people will recognize to you that even they don't really know what are the effects, what will be going on. For example, if you are from Germany or close to, you remember how when I was younger, some 20, 30 years ago, the big topic was Waldsterben, the dying of forests. No? Now we know that there are now more forests than at any point around the world in the last 100 years. That the paradox of this global warming and carbon dioxide and so on is that forests drive more. So it's like, you know, the problem is that we are compelled of making choices without having the core. We know many things, but we know too many conflicting things and so on and so on. As the French, British well-known pessimist John Gray put it, we are forced to live as if we were free, without even having the coordinates. The same question, my political diagnosis is the following one. For me, the countries, there are two countries of future in Europe, Italy and Poland. Poland, why? Because it, I'm referring to the last electoral results, because they are where we are all heading, I claim. The way it looks now, the future is either you have no longer have left and right, you have one neutral technocratic party and then a right-wing populist party. And that's, I think, what is gradually emerging. The new division is pure universalist technocrats, usually more multicultural, blah, 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 enlightened capitalists and populists. And the true danger of all this crisis, of course, is the rise of populism. Because populism, if there is a zero level definition of populism, it's a refusal of knowledge. Populism is, I don't know what goes on, but I cannot stand it. You know, it's always this, I'm not interested in this refusal of complexity, which is why, incidentally, although I don't expect too much from Obama, I think Obama will be, if he will succeed, a great conservative president. In what sense? You know how in often in the history there are things which are progressive leftist, but only a right-winger can do them. For example, it was only Nixon who could have made pact with China. If a left president were to do it, he would be immediately attacked, oh, communist, soft of communism. Or only De Gaulle was able to give independence to Algeria. If socialists were to do it, you have to have right-wing credentials to do the necessary lefty thing. I think that today with Obama is exactly the opposite. There is this, as the noble word for brutal things, necessary restructuring to do it, and it's, if Bush were to do it, everybody would explode, brutal capitalists and so on. It's only someone with leftist credentials who can do it. So, in this completely blurred situation, again, I fear that that's the political scene today, a very sad one. Either That's for me the lesson of the last Polish elections, the lesson of Italian, not so much elections. Ah, Berlusconi is here an interesting phenomenon because he brings the two together. He's neutral technocrat, but at the same time playing the populist card, which is why it's almost getting more and more difficult to oppose him. But I was thinking about other things in Italy. Something strange is going on, which, if you ask me frankly, is a premonition of where we are heading. Now I'm talking about the last antagonism which is exploding, the antagonism between excluded and included. We are more and more, I claim, approaching a kind of a universal gated community where there simply is a larger and larger part of our populations who live in slums, are de facto excluded, and so on and so on. So in Italy, you know, the only way to fight it, and we should learn to fight it otherwise, is of course a kind of a permanent emergency state. And are you even aware that this is what they did in Italy? It was a small note, but it shattered me. In the newspapers, that, do you know that half a year ago, the Berlusconi government proclaimed a permanent state of emergency in all of Italy? What did this mean? First, they deployed, it was even popular by the people. The catch is that in this way, they can legally, because you can do this in democratic countries only in an emergency state, you can deploy army in your own state, in the cities and so on. First they did it in Napoli against the mafia, now then against the immigrant threat. Now they are starting serials, it's not a joke, to use army units to fight rapes and prostitution and so on and so on. Now you will tell me, but wait a minute, I was last week in Rome, it's not so horrible. That's, I think, our future. A kind of a, it's no longer this clear even opposition between state of exception and normal state. Sometimes, somehow, state of exception will get gradually normalized. And the sad thing is then that in this new political space, the only protest remaining is a totally irrational, violent protest. I think that another indicator here are, you remember the cars that were burning in Paris suburbs 2 years ago and a little bit now. These protests, I think, are an exemplary of today's politics. They are very mysterious, you know. They were not, as some right-wingers first thought, Islamist protests, or these of suburban youth. No, the first thing they burned were the local mosques and their cultural center, Islamic. The second shock, they didn't have any program. It's not, we want this, we want that. It was just what in linguistics we call phatic communication. You know, like, hey, I'm here, I want to be noted. Like, just to be noted. And so, again, here, I'm not saying it should be absolutely not the old left, but I think that somehow, something that we once called socialism, communism, whatever, will have to be reinvented. Absolutely not in the same way, don't be afraid, I'm not trying to sell you, haha, a new Leninist party, where, who will do it, it's crazy, whatever. Just that, to be very precise, we will have to discover a new mode of collective acting. Everybody knows this in a way, even big powers when they meet in Bali to debate and do nothing. A new form of, even across the states, transnational social political activity, which will not be market oriented, but also not simply state controlled. Because I think that we are approaching on all these levels, ecology, intellectual property chaos, or these new forms of apartheid, we are approaching a kind of a apocalyptic final point. I'm not saying it will be catastrophe, I'm saying it's apocalyptic final point where then I claim, I have nothing against the ongoing relatively well-functioning Western European liberal capitalism. What I'm saying is that it cannot last. I give it the way it is, if you ask me, 20 years maximum. And I think the future will be then either a kind of a new gated authoritarian community. We will have to have, this will be the synthesis of Europe and Asia, and this is what Putin is offering us, a kind of a European democracy with Asian values, as I put it, no? Or we will invent something. It's not so much, and there is a problem here. What problem? In contrast to old Marxism, We don't have the train of history on our side. You know, that's what is so nostalgic, admirable about the old Marxists, who thought historical necessity is on our side. You know, we just, development is necessary and so on and so on. There is no train of history. And so when somebody tells you, oh, but I see the light at the end of the tunnel, we from ex-Eastern Europe, we know very well what's our first reaction. When somebody tells you it's not as bad, there is light at the end of the tunnel, it's probably, yes, another train is coming towards us, no? I would like to make this, my metaphor is that of Walter Benjamin, you know, the German theoretician, who claimed the metaphor today shouldn't be, we should ride the train of history towards progress, but the train is running without a driver, pilot, whatever, to the end, we should put the emergency brakes. We should stop. And so we don't have history on our side. Which is why, again, knowledge, organization is more necessary than ever. We cannot have this either capitalist or communist trust either on invisible hand of market or on invisible hand of history or whatever. There is no, if anything, destiny is against us. We cannot say that we are in higher harmony with destiny, no? We have to be active. And that's the true challenge. You cannot do it without knowledge. Against all those new agers who claim we know too much, we try to know too much, we need this kind of, how to put it, to rediscover ourselves, find a way back to intimate communication with Earth and so on and so on. No, I say quite on the contrary. We need more alienation. I think precisely, let me just conclude with this. For example, take ecology. I claim that so-called deep mystical ecology, you know, we are too much involved with techniques, we need to find a deeper link vibrating with our life world. That's the formula of catastrophe for me. Why? Because what we have to accept is precisely that there is no nature. Nature in this mythical sense, you know, Mother Earth that we betrayed and so on. What is nature? Nature is one big ecological catastrophe. Oil, we use oil. What is oil? Can we even imagine the ecological catastrophe which produced oil reserves? This is again what we have to accept. Even there is no Mother Earth that we violated and we have to return to it. There is the abyss of chaos, nothing. The only thing is to accept this totally open situation and accept the risks and trust our knowledge. We need knowledge more than ever. I'm sorry if I was too long, but that's life, I talk too much. At least you know why my friends call me Fidel. Like Fidel Castro, comrades, just